In the previous lesson of this 3D animation course for beginners, you learned all about how to navigate around in Blender, how to create and manipulate an object. In this video, we are going to take the ball that we've created and snap it to a ground plane. Then we'll grab the camera and find a nice framing for our bouncing ball animation that we'll be doing over the course of this series. If you're brand new to animation, this is the tutorial series for you. And now let's jump into it and quite literally set the stage for our bouncing ball animation. We already have our main actor, the ball. This is the ball that's gonna be our bouncing ball by the end of this little series. But we also want the ball to bounce on a ground. So let's add a floor. As always, before creating an object, you should make sure that this 3D cursor is set in a position that makes sense for you. Earlier, we were playing around with the cursor tool, and when you click around while this cursor tool is active, the 3D cursor will just jump around in the scene, and if you create an object now, it will be created at that position. In our case, I want the ground plane to be created in the middle of our scene, so I want to reset the 3D cursor to be there. You can do that in object mode by right-clicking, choosing snap, and then selecting cursor to world origin. And now we can add a ground, a plane. We do that by hitting shift A, mesh, and we're creating a plane. So you can see it cuts kind of through our ball, but that's okay for now. Let's zoom out and use S to make this plane very large. You can, of course, also type a size here in the scale part of the property panel. It's currently set to 34. Let's just set it to 40 in all these coordinates. And here we have a nice huge floor. Right now, the ball is stuck halfway in the ground. We want to move him out of there. I still have the cursor tool active, which is why I cannot click on objects. So I switch back to the select box tool, make sure that I have the sphere selected, and I can pull it out of the ground by hitting G for grab, and then Z to move it up. But as you can see, it's kind of hard to find the position exactly where the sphere is no longer in the ground. Go and look from below, you can see that it is still sticking out on the other side of the plane. But we can make the sphere snap to a position on the ground. Let's move it back into it so I can show it to you more clearly. We can activate snapping by clicking up here with the symbol that actually makes a lot of sense for snapping, the magnet. And right now, snapping is to the coordinate system. So you can see it jumping around in these increments as it is snapping to the nearest full number in our coordinate system. But this is not what we want. We want the ball to snap to the surface of the ground. And the surface of something in 3D is defined by something called a face. If just for a second we go to edit mode, you don't need to do that. I just want to show you real quick. I select the sphere, I hit tab to enter edit mode. And now you can see that our sphere is made from all these vertices, these points at the edge of these little squares. In our sphere, most of the time, four of these vertices make up a face. So let's jump out of edit mode again by pressing tab. We are back in object mode now. You can verify that by having a look up here in that toolbar where you can change the mode between edit mode and object mode. And you can see that the ground is just one big face. So in our options next to the magnet symbol, we can change what it is snapping towards from increment to face project. So now that we have snapping set up in this way, we can select the ball, hit G for grab, and Z to move it along the Z axis, And in my case, it's snapping to the underside of the ground right now, which of course is not what we want. So let's just briefly deactivate snapping, move the ball a little bit out of the ground, and then activate snapping again. And now if I hit G and Z, as you can see, it snaps to the top side of the ground right now. And then we can click, and the ball is sitting perfectly on the ground. Now let's have a look through the camera by hitting zero, and you can see that the ball is kind of sitting at the top half of the frame. There's no room for the ball to bounce. We're just way too close and pointing the camera way too far down. Now, positioning the camera can be a little bit tricky, especially if you are new to 3D. We can actually select the camera from within the camera view, but you can see that if we do anything, it's kind of difficult. Oh, we still have the snapping activated. We might want to deactivate that. You can see that this can be kind of tricky. It is helpful to use the axis and move around to find a framing that we like, but usually you might want to have a look at your camera from the outside. So we want to see what's going on from the outside, and at the same time we want to see the scene from the perspective of the camera. So we need to split our viewport so we can keep an eye on two things at once. In Blender you can split viewports and panels to fill them with even more viewports and panels. Let's do our first split by going to that upper edge, right click, and then select vertical split. And now we can position where we would like the viewport to split. This is not that important because you can always go in and change that. So let's do not completely 50-50, but a comfortable area right here. And then we have two viewports, and in the left viewport, we can go into the camera view to see the scene from the perspective of the camera, maybe zoom in and out a little bit. Yeah, you can put this in a way that works for you the most. We can put that item toolbar away right here also by clicking and pushing it in. And you can always bring it back if you want. This way, the Blender interface is very flexible and you can organize and split everything just the way you would like it to be. Here, we can start panning freely in this other viewport to see our scene a little bit more from the side. Or if you want to, you can hit 3 to see it really from this side angle. Now, by looking from the outside, it's a bit easier to move the camera around. We can refer to the axis indicator up here to know what axis we might want to change. It's also very important to think about the rotation. I think I don't want to look down at our scene quite so much. So let's rotate our camera, make sure that it is selected, and hit R. And now we can try the different axes. Let's hit Z. And yeah, this kind of makes sense. Okay, we can position our ball where we want it to be in the frame, maybe pushing it over to the left a little bit. But if we hit R and Y for the Y axis, it's just giving us this weird diagonal camera motion. And if we hit X, it's the same thing in the other direction. And that's not really useful. This is not how a human would operate a camera on a tripod. Let's hit Escape to get out of this rotation mode and change the way how Blender calculates these rotations and transformations. Right now, up here, the transform orientations are set to global. Let's switch on the rotation tool in the toolbar to really see what that means. If you orbit around the camera, and we can do that by hitting dot or comma on the numpad, you can see that our rotation axis align with the global axis of the screen. The blue axis, for example, is just laying flat on the ground of our scene. If you change the move tool, you can see that the move tool is exactly aligned to the global axis of the world. Now for the camera, and very often during animation, one mode that you might want to switch to is the local transform orientation. So let's click on that, and we can already see that the axis changed a lot for our camera. You can see that now the transformation is aligned with the orientation of the camera. And the same goes for the rotation. If we switch back to the rotation tool, you can now see that this behaves a lot more how a human would operate a camera on a tripod. We can tilt the camera up and down, left and right, and twist it sideways. And these are very much exactly the options that we have on a tripod as well. And it's a lot easier to adjust the camera in local mode. So we can make sure that the camera is not pointing down quite so much, then switch to our transform tool, make sure that we're going down, and maybe we're gonna wanna go back a little bit here, just pulling it back like this, and maybe position it to one side like this. Right now it feels a little bit like the camera is tilted. Let's see if we can change this with one of the axes, switching that back to zero. I think this should be much better now. One thing you should pay attention to, that if you hit the numpad keys that we learned earlier, that these still make sense in the way that we have set up the scene. For example, if you switch to front, this should actually still be the front of the scene. And you can see that the camera kind of wandered a little bit to the side. I kind of want to make sure that our camera is also coming from the front, so our global world axis still makes sense. Let's switch back to global for a second and make sure that my camera is coming from the front, something like this. And then going to the side view, and yeah, here we make sure that we're coming from the side, but at the moment we can't really see the ball. The top view is probably gonna help us see this a little more clearly. Switch to the rotate tool, make sure that we're rotating it into view. Maybe going back a little bit more, might wanna switch back to local to do that. Pull it back, and I think now we are approaching a composition that I would like to have for our bouncing ball animation. Last but not least, I want to show you a different method for setting the camera position. And in this one, we are just using the free pan 3D view to find our position. Once again, I think I want to respect where the front of our world is, so I can hit numpad 1 to make sure that I see our scene from the front, and then build my position from here. Maybe we can try something a little bit lower, something like this, where the ball cuts through the horizon. I want it to be on the left. And once I think, okay, this could be the base for my camera position, I can hit Control Alt numpad 0. And then our camera jumps to that spot in the scene. You can see it's not perfect. Our ball is cut off here, but this is easy to correct. Let's jump to the top view with numpad 7 and just move our camera back a little bit. That's one of the options that you have to position your camera. And you can see that this camera is very close to the ground here. That might be an interesting bouncing ball animation, or we just go back to the one that we had before. Here we're looking down from the top a little bit more. But yeah, maybe you find a nice position for your camera using this method. In the next video of this animation series, we will actually be animating something. We will set keyframes and have the ball jump up and down. And we'll also have a look at this scary looking graph editor thingy and find out what that is all about. If you never want to miss a video, please hit subscribe here, and then you always know when a new video is coming out. Thank you so very much for watching. These are my Patreon supporters. If you like my tutorials and you would like me to make more and more live streams, please consider supporting me as well. Thank you so much. Hope to see you again soon. Bye.